Well, thank you so much for doing this interview with us. It's really an honor. It's really wonderful to speak to you. And I really wanted to ask you, who was La Lupe beyond her onstage persona?
Well, it's a pleasure meeting you. Thank you once again for this opportunity. I take off my hat to you as a young person to be able to do this. I also acknowledge Aurora Flores. Thank you so very much. And to answer your question, who is La Lupe beyond her stage persona? Well, La Lupe was a very strong woman on stage and in her personal life. She was very loving. She was caring. She was funny. Una cómica. Like she was a mother. Very endearing, you know, a bit strict, but, you know, I turned out all right, you know. So as far as, you know, beyond the stage persona, she was basically a normal person, a normal, empowered woman.
But you were born Rainbow Garcia, and
yes,
your father was also Monero. I knew your father. I was in a group with your father, Willie Garcia, and for the second child, right? Yes. Second child?
My mother, it's two of us. It's my brother, Rene Camano, and myself, Rainbow Charity Garcia, also known as La Yoli, with hyphen, you know, to serve you guys. Mm-hmm. And she had two children, yes.
Yeah, I wanted to know, how did you feel watching your mother on stage?
Well, I watched my mother on stage first time I was 11, and ever since, you know, I watched most, including, you know, in her Christian life, but we'll get into that later. I felt very proud, although I was a child. And I really didn't understand the lights and, you know, the music or whatever. But you see me, there's actually a video on YouTube. She's singing live, Que Te Pedí. And you see me just so very proud. And that was my mommy. So I all I could say is very proud of her. And, you know, in my heart from then, it stimulated me as far as music. And the interest of music. In my house, in our household, everything was music. We're gonna clean, let's put music. We're getting in the car with the German Shepherd, let's put music. So, you know, I have to say I'm very proud seeing her in stage, singing in the shower, just very proud of her ability of shaking people.
Did it give you a sense of empowerment as a little girl, seeing your mother, being able to have, I mean, it's a certain control, right? Like all these people applauding her.
Like I said, I didn't understand it because I was a child, but I did see, you know, the thump, the people jumping and a loop and just seeing the people, how they absorbed her energy. And appreciated her song and, you know, the cutting veins type of boleros type of thing. You know, it was amazing and I'm very proud and exciting for me. So, you know, I wasn't a normal child. I was always, you know, under the light or under the, you know, okay, yeah, she would carry me like this everywhere, you know, and, you know, that's something I'm very proud of. So it will make me feel very proud.
I think she was very proud of you too. I mean, I do remember a cover. There was a cover shot of her in the hospital, and she had just had you, I think. And here she is in the hospital bed with you. You were just born, and she has the wig, and she has full makeup, and she has the nails. And I'm like, how did she do that? And I remember in one of the many interviews that have been done on La Lupe, that when she got to the hospital, the doctor was saying, oh, she, you know, she has to take all that off. You know, she's going to give birth. And she said, no, I'm La Lupe. And she did it. There's that picture. And she was so proud of you. She really was. Yeah. And she was also one of a kind. She was one of a kind.
And I remember, I think, todo. La vida me ha dado todo, la tristeza, la pobreza, la alegría, la verdad. And she would go like this. Yeah, when she did this gesture, as she sang, you know, she meant her children, you know? So, yes, I agree. She loved her kids.
She was proud of you guys. She was. Yes. Nani?
What did she think of the industry and what was her biggest frustration with it?
Okay, I want to make a point clear. I was born 1970 something, right? So when she was at her peak, I was a baby, you know? But from what I did experience as I grew up, what I think, I'm going to give you a hypothesis because as an educated guess, because I don't really know what was in her mind. You know, I was 10, 11, 12, you know, but now as an adult and revising things, you know, because I'm always revising things of my mom and just researching and just, you know, experimenting. I think that what she thought about the industry, it was, and I have to be blunt with stuff, you know, it was a man-ruled industry back then in the 60s and 70s, you know? And that was number one. So that took some power. And I think, a hypothesis, she thought it was unfair, the industry. A lot of people turned her back on her when she made a lot of money for herself and for the music industry, as far as companies and stuff like that, which I'm not going to mention, you know, because lo que pasó, pasó. The past is the past. But she thought that that was frustrating to having to battle, you know, in a man's world and continue to have your femininity, but always have to turn on your masculine energy. So that was one of the main frustrations that I could remember. Other than that, she didn't really care. Like, she did her own thing. I don't know if anybody knows, but she did a English album. It was all English, and it's called La Lupe Does Her Own Thing. So I cling to that because literally she did her own thing. Like throughout everything, you know, she came to New York and lived in 147th Street and put a little bird cage out of Cuba to Mexico to, you know, alone. And, you know, she did it her way. So, you know, that's what I could tell you about that.
What did she enjoy the most about the industry? When was she most in her element?
Oh, okay. I could remember one of her best, Carnegie Hall, sold out. Not everyone went to Carnegie Hall, and she did that on her own. Madison Square Garden, sold out. Teatro Puerto Rico, that's here in the Bronx, in by Brook Avenue. It's a church now, but Teatro Puerto Rico, people lined up. Blocks and blocks and blocks, you know, and that was a great success. That was memorable. Madison Square Garden, Carnegie Hall, Teatro Puerto Rico. This is all in New York City. And she was the first, and I'm very proud once again, she was the first Latin woman to be accepted in the American television back in the 60s, early 70s. She was the first woman that went to the Dick Cavett show and killed it with her broken English and everything. And they embraced her and he loved her and they had a great time. So that's like a icon type of thing. That's one of her epic moments that we could add on to that.
When she was on the black music station and she was singing "Don't Play It No More." Oh my God, right? That's iconic. And probably why she did an English LP. And one of my questions to you later on is going to be about the more modern music. But back in the 70s, I heard your mother sing a rap song, and she was rapping. I was amazed. I was like, wow. She was ahead of her.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. She did, her last album was En Algo Nuevo. To my knowledge, that was 1985. That was her last album, En Algo Nuevo, and it's called Sol Salsa. And it's about a round bed. She literally had a round bed. And she was rapping about her round bed. Yo tengo una camita bien redondita, redondita, you know.
Ay, ay, yo tengo una camita que es todita redondita, y la gente que la mira se me queda dormida. Yo le digo, mira papi, párate de esta camita es mía, muy bonita y muy bonita. Me han cortado un dedito y me han dado una paliza, y no quiero nada en el corte de mi camita, porque esta camita tiene, tú sabes qué, Sol Salsa.
So she was ahead of her time. She would rap, she would cry, she would sing, she did everything. Venezuela, joropo, mambo, bolero, bomba, salsa, hasta merengue, la lloradora.
Antonia es una mujer, ella llora por el canto. Si a usted se le muere alguien, ella va a llorar un rato. Ella llora por dinero, con ataque y sin ataque. Si quiere que bese al muerto, tiene que pagarle aparte.
You know, so she was, you know, she was a piece of everybody's world. And I think that's something, not because she's my mother, but for someone to have the ability to be able to adjust to every gender of music, that's a musical genius to me.
And what do you think, if someone were to ask La Lupe what her best work was, what do you think she would say?
Like I said, Madison Square Garden, Carnegie Hall, Teatro Puerto Rico, you know, those were the most impacted. Like everywhere and every show that she did was out of control, and you never knew what to expect. That's why people pay to go and see her, because it was always something different. Like she could climb from one end of the curtain to the other and caerle a golpe a los músicos, you know, throw a shoe at the musicians, and people loved it. So it was always different, you know, but those are, like I said, Madison Square Garden, Carnegie Hall, Teatro Puerto Rico, the Cabot Show, you know, those are the main iconic things that I could remember of.
But in terms of her songs, I think Anani was trying to get
her
songs. What do you think her favorite song?
One of her favorites? Wow. She liked Oriente. She really liked Oriente.
Cantarte como deseo. La tierra donde maceo. Alcanzo la luz primera.
Because it was, you know, it's from Cuba, and you know, she had a love for her hometown. And as the story goes, we all know that Fidel said, "See ya," at the time of the revolution, because instead of having a revolution for the Olupismo, people were going to the clubs to see her. So he was like, "Bye-bye, here you go," in a nice way. So, you know, she never returned to her town, to her hometown. So Oriente, she did that with feeling, and that's why she, you know, interpreted the way she did. You know, Oriente was one of her good ones. I know she liked Buen Viaje.
Merece la pena de llorar porque te vas. quien te quiere, esperando estará.
You know, she likes to send people away once they're not too good. You know, buen viaje. ¿Qué te pedí?
Que supieras que no hay en la vida otro amor como mi amor.
Because nadie te lo puede cantar como te lo cantó la Lupe, ni yo. Nobody could sing that like la Lupe sang it. So she had a few of, you know, her favorites. But believe it or not, I'll tell you guys a little exclusive. She never liked, even in her Christian life, she never liked to see herself or hear herself after performance. Whatever's done is done. That was just how it was. And that's a little exclusive for you, Aurora. So.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I understand that feeling, I have to tell you. After later on performing and having my, I understand that feeling.
Yeah.
After done, yeah, let me go on to the next side. Oh my God, that's very.
I guess people criticize her own self as an artist. You know, everybody has their own form or ways and fashion to do stuff. However, it came out, it came out. Si pusimos un huevo, fíjate ya, se finish. You know, and that's what I said. Every time was something different. Every time was a new excitement. Every time was, you know, people didn't know what to expect, and that's what attracts a public. And she was an outcast, you know? So.
Yeah. Now, I know Mongo picked her up right away. And you can hear her, I think it's her laughing on Watermelon Man.
Yes.
Watermelon Man. They made, yeah. Mm-hmm. But I have to say, Cortijo has.
And he said, pon los micrófonos, let her sit here and let her do her thing. And that's all she did. And, you know, Sonia. And she had this thing that was just her, you know? So it worked. It worked for her, public, it worked for people that loved her. Whatever, what I could say is whatever the public liked, that's what she would do. Whatever worked for them and then her, that's what she would do. So like I said, if you got to beat up, not really beat up, but you know, hit a musician and do it faster and people loved it, that's what she would do. You know, taking her jewelry, giving it to the people. That was, I asked her once, Mom, why would you do that? You know, she goes, it's an offering to my people.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
And she would do jewelry and just, you know, a little piece of her. And at that time, she could do that, you know? Throw millions, thousands of dollars in jewelry.
You know?
But
yeah. Like you said at the beginning, it was and continues to be a man's world. Mm-hmm. And I know she had issues there. I know some of the other musicians, they were scared of her because I saw a video where she came near one of the conga players. And you can see the conga player going like, he's going like this. He's a fan. Uh-huh. However, the two people who would talk to me so, they would be excited for you, was Cortijo and Imael Rivera. And I remember mm-hmm. Cortijo saying, I think he saw you in teatro. He saw you. Well, he saw your mother in Teatro Puerto Rico. And he said he had to get out of his seat and go to the stage. And when they took her off, he was screaming, tráeme la loca, tráela. He saw that there was something so special about her. And mm-hmm. I know there's a really sweet photo I've seen in black and white of Cortijo and Maelo kind of making like a little swing for her with their arms. Mm-hmm. And she's like swinging with Cortijo. I mean, I got really good vibes from them about your mother back then.
Yes.
Okay.
And I welcomed them into this interview because we weren't speaking to, you know, about those masters, pero Ismael Rivera, like, you know, eso es un pedazo de cielo. My mother loved him very much and respected him as an artist, you know, so.
What was behind the conflict with Tito Puente and how serious was it?
Okay, the conflict with Tito Puente that I know of is, que once again, a man's world, and Luigi Progreso, we love Tito very much. We respect him very much. He wanted things his way, and she wanted things her way. So, but when it was showtime, boom, lo rompía. They will make it, they will work, and 2 minutes later, they were kissing each other, hugging each other, like they were brothers and sisters. When my mother passed in 1992, Mr. Ralph Mercado, Mr. Tito Puente, and Polito Vega, they went to the funeral. And Tito Puente went and he hugged my mother and kissed her and cried at the coffin. So they had a very special bond, you know, as far as, you know, great artists, great icons uniting, especially at that time, and making stuff happen, you know, but it wasn't that serious. They loved each other, back to the point. But that was the conflict. She wanted things her way, he wanted things his way, and you know, but at the end, everything fell into compliance and it became a success. Everything.
Anani?
Yes. I also wanted to ask, how did Fania's refusal to promote La Lupe affect her?
All right, that's a touchy-feely, but I'm gonna include myself with that because at that time I was up to age between 10 and 12 years old and I experienced it, you know? And it affected us very, very harshly because to make things clear, there was no work. So she couldn't feed her children. She couldn't do what she had to do as a mother with generating income as an artist as she wanted to. So it impacted us a lot, but we overcame and we always ate for the grace of God. But yeah, it impacted us a little hard. It tumbled us, but it didn't make us fall. And we offer forgiveness at this point, and we pray for everyone that, you know, did give her back and, you know, did things the wrong way for them to be divinely guided and protected. That's my prayer, because at this point we can't hold grudges. Lo que pasó, pasó. What happened is over. And we're here to experience a new journey, a new revival, and, you know, lots of bliss. And we can dwell on the past, but yeah, things weren't done too correctly and it affected us, but we still did good. She still smiled. She still fed me. She still made jokes. We still had animals. So, you know, it was a little, you know, stepping stone, you know, type of thing, but we prevailed.
Your mother was so resilient. That's the one thing I see about her. When they all had that thing about Tito Puente Me Botó and all that, what did she do? She went on the talk show scene and became a hit, which was amazing. And then when that happened with Fania, now I know that when she passed, you were already 17 years old. So yeah, you went through that with her. And she went from living, you guys lived in New Jersey in a mansion, to then move to the South Bronx. And she did what she had to do.
La Lupe's Way is 575 East 140th Street. It was brand new, nuevecito. It was in the projects. It was just a, you know, according to your income building. We had washing machines. We had security guards. You know, it was a glass, you know, building, which it still is. So it wasn't like dumps, you know.
As they make it seem, yeah.
It was a big change, you know. And prior to that, we suffered a fire that we're not going to get into that. But you know, it was a transformation, you know, that she had to adapt herself as a star, as a performer, and to have to, you know, have a bit of a downfall because of the industry.
But like you said, she was resilient. She still fed her kids. She still smiled. She still had music. And this is what I'm talking about, her resiliency. There's a certain, and within all that, taking care of a sick husband, because she loved him. She loved him.
Oh, yeah. To the very last day. Yes.
So there's a resilience there that had to impact you also.
Yeah, I was born in the beginning of February and she died at the last. She was so different. She even died in a leap year, on a leap year. Like, who does that? So she passed away in 1992, February 29th. I had just turned 70. I was in my last year of high school. So it was like my stability was taken out of from under my feet. So I was flowing, but because of her strength and her capacity of continuing to move forward and being positive and optimistic in everything in her life, especially when it involved her children, it taught me, okay, get it together. And guess what? You don't really know what to do. You're gonna do A, B, C, and D. And I did it. And I did it on my own, and I had help from my brother. You know, and yeah, imagine, you know, God forbid, God bless you, 16, turning 17, losing your mom, everything you had, that's all I had. So yeah, it was a very hard impact, but it made me as strong as her, maybe even stronger. And that's why I'm the woman that I am today. And she taught me how to turn struggle into power. And I appreciate that. She taught me how to drive at 12 years old.
She
had a big wagon. She said, get in. I said, no.
Those memories of your mother, like back then, it's good that you say that, because a lot of the newspaper, you know, they would say, oh, she went from living in a mansion to the South Bronx, and they made it seem like it was a walk, you know. Like, so it's good that you said. But it's also good that you showed us how strong she was with everything she went through, how strong she was, and teaching you how to drive at 12 years old in the city, in New York City.
Right. It was always about survival. And what I admired the most is, no matter what we were going through, she never let me know there was a problem. Todo está bien, cucusa. Todo está bien. Everything's okay, mommy. Everything's okay, mamita. Everything's okay, even though things weren't okay, you know? So I admire that. She always kind of made everything past it.
Yeah.
Even though we were running through fires.
She made a game of running through fire.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And only La Lupe could do that. I know one of the questions Anani had come up with was her faith in the Orishas. I mean, she made that very public. She had an album where she was dressed and she sang to the Orishas on stage and everything. She knew the language.
Yes, she was very, very serious, very respectful, very thrown into her Orisha Santeria religion. Yes, very passionate. And what people don't understand, that, you know, she'll go like this, and, you know, the rumors that she did this and that, and no, she would do santo in the Orisha. I'm going to speak quickly about this. You have birthday parties as far as when you turn your saints, it's their birthday, and you do parties. So the santos come down in the tambores, they call tambores, right? Yeah, the santo never comes down in the tambores, the santo will come down on the stage. And that's what people didn't understand, and that's another exclusive for you. Pero that's another little exclusive. You know, people don't really understand, you know, how could this woman like rip stages apart and this and that and carry a conga, whatever. It was her spirit guides that would come down. So yes, she was very, very, very passionate about her religion with her orishas and Santeria. But at one point, I wouldn't say everyone, but I guess God chose her. And at one point, she had an experience, intimate experience with God. That's when she decided that God wanted a different path for her, you know? And very respectfully and recently, she faded away from that. But she had to listen to God's calling because she had an experience with him. And after that, that's how she got saved and became a ordained minister, Pentecostal, Christian. The last 9 years of her life, she was an ordained minister, Pentecostal. She would go around the whole world. We went everywhere telling her testimony. So La Lupe was just from a teacher. Okay, from a Caribe singer in Cuba to a teacher, to coming to New York, to becoming famous, to becoming a santera, to you know, having it all, losing most, and then being lifted up in the Christianity. And let me tell you something, even if she was Christian and she was going preach or whatever, she still had that same demeanor.
I heard some of her Christian songs.
And she wrote all of her songs. She did 9 albums. 9. She wrote all of her songs. And, you know, when she would say her testimony, people would look at her like, you know, like as far as what she would do with the Santos or whatever. And people would look at her, you know, the Christian people, the ladies. And she's like, don't look at me like that because I would do that. But lady, I don't know what you did. Oh! Con el amor de Cristo, with Christ's love, but she was a turmoil in the church, you know, but with lots of love, a little more passive than in the secular world.
No, I love how she blasted their hypocrisy. She saw right through it. She saw right through it. And only Lupe could do that.
That's right. Oh, so that's how she became. You know, that's how the transformation came. Some people think, oh, she had no choice. She was broke. And then she went into the Christian community. No, no. My mother was paralyzed in a wheelchair from an accident that she had. If you find her testimony, she says it herself. And, you know, I have to say that God lifted her up from that wheelchair. I pushed that wheelchair at 13 years old. You know, took care of her, you know, and my schooling and everything. So I know the reality, you know, so I cannot, you know, put that in the back burner because I know how real God was in her life at that time, how he manifested himself. And she devoted her last 9 years to him. And guess what? It was the happiest years we had. I have to say, we were content. We weren't hungry, you know, she was happy, you know, she gained a little weight, she got a little older, but, you know, and even her songs, that voice was still Lupe. So that's amazing, you know, to be able to have that transformation and still be known by that voice, even if you change your life. I don't know if you get me.
I get you. And I had gotten some of her, they were cassettes, I remember, of her, some of her Christian songs. And when I heard it, I mean, there's no mistaking. That's La Lupe.
Yeah.
Except the words were different, but the energy, the voice, the passion, it was there. You could not mistake that for anyone else.
That's right.
And you know, sometimes, again, and it's because it's all very much of a patriarchy and an all-male society. And I think it was so unfair at that time to just have two women. And they would make these two women compete. And I'm sorry, but I would not put Celia and Lupe in the same room. Completely different voices, completely, completely different styles. So, but it was like a mentality like, oh, we're only gonna have one. It was not good, because I think that, you know, there's no one like La Lupe, no one. And you can't compare her to anyone.
And I must say, there's no one like Celia. Rest in power, Celia. Love yes. you very much. Lupe was Lupe. La Lupe was the queen of Latin soul. And Celia Cruz was Celia Cruz. So it was, they came from the same kind of world. They were both Cuban, everything, but it was different styles. So you can't add from any of them because they had their own thing. So I guess at that time they had to pick the more subtleness, which I don't mean subtleness. I mean, she was a goddess, you know? Pero they had to make a choice. And yeah, it was messed up. And I don't think that, you know, they made each other. They had rivalry. It was the industry, the music company. They did, you know, like.
They didn't even have the same voices. La Lupe was more of a soprano. Celia mm-hmm. was an alto. You know, right. Celia was la guarachera del mundo. And La Exacto. Lupe was the queen of Latin soul.
Exacto. Entonces, mira, hasta en Oriente, Amari, just so you know, Oriente is one of her very famous songs that, back to the beginning, it's from her hometown in Cuba. Even when she sings Oriente, she says, y esto es para Celia, que es mi inspiración. This one's dedicated to Celia. That's my inspiration. So if she had any type of, you know, how we say here in New York, beef, you know, she would give her props. So they didn't really have between each other. The companies did that, you know, and if they did, they kept it away from me. And I mean, like, you know, they were very private, but, you know, like my mother and I, we were very close, and she would tell me like, never, never. She always praised Celia. It mm-hmm. was just a different type of people, different type of energies, different type of swags. That's all. Pero no se le puede quitar a la reina Celia Cruz, Luz y Progreso, rest in power. No se le puede.
And that's what I'm saying, yeah. I completely agree with you. Anani, you had a good question coming up. Like, what do you think of the way she's often portrayed?
Yes.
Anani?
Yes, yes. What do you think the way she's often portrayed? I mean, there's so many different things we hear about her, documentaries and books and all these things. What do you think about the way she's portrayed in many of these things?
Well, as far as books, just to be clear, as far as the family, we authorize one book. If there's other books out there, girl, we'll come see you in divine timing. But there was one authorized book for her family, which is her living heirs, my brother, Rene Camano, and I, and once again, Rainbow Garcia, also known as La Jolie, with hyphen, which was called Defamation of Una Diva, por La Lupe, and was written by Juan Moreno, Rainbow Charity Garcia, and Rene Kaman. And that book was, I will say, 85% facts, because it was our story as her children, dressing, you know, what we lived with her. Rene in his era, and myself in the era that I lived with her. You know, I don't want to put it this way, but he kind of had the good life then when I was born, you know, but we balanced, you know, we all stood family. But that's the only book that was authorized. And I think we did a great job. As far as the author following the directions and our petitions, as far as the book, I don't think it was followed correctly. As far as there was a CD put and we asked to put songs only that she wrote so we could get royalties, and that wasn't done. But like I said, the past is the past. Everybody makes mistakes, you know. I appreciate the author just to have the interest to write a book with us and be in compliance with us for children, you know, to write a book on her. But as far as the aftermath and whatever happened after, and if they follow directions, I'm not too sure, but what's in the books is actually in that book is facts, because it comes from the mouth of Rainbow Garcia and Renee Camano, her two children. And all the pictures provided was provided by me, myself. So, you know, I think we all worked really hard and we fell into compliance to do this. Whatever happened after, you know, we don't know.
So I just have two more questions, but what was it like growing up with her as your mother?
Like I said, she was funny. She was very private as far as, you know, low-key type of thing. She would never, like, go to my school and be like, I'm Lupe. No, you know. And I was a good girl. I barely got in trouble, so there was no calling to school. Yay, you know. But she was very low-key of who she was in the fame, and very open as a parent, a animal parent, a provider, you know, a loving person, and normal. Like, she would cook. She would make jokes. She was so funny. I remember there was a song, Ariel Speedwagon. I can't fight this feeling anymore. And she would act it out. And that was our joke. And I'm here 10 years old. Wah, 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 wah. So she would do little special little things like that for us. And, you know, just normal stuff. She loved hamsters. She had hamsters. She had a white German shepherd. So, you know, she was a normal, loving, caring, funny. No cocinaba muy bueno, pero cocinaba. She was so good. Like, you know, just normal stuff, laundry, you know, just normal stuff. I want people to realize La Lupe in stage was La Lupe in stage. And then when she got home, she was just like one of you, one of us. She was a strong, independent, caring woman for her children and her stability the best that she could. Whether we had it or not, she made it happen.
She truly and did.
That from her.
And I love the way you say that, because, you know, people have this conception about artists.
We put on a kind of like a mask.
We do.
For our audience. You know, we're just not going to go in a t-shirt and sunglasses and red lips or whatever. You know, her thing was extraordinary. Yes. But at home, estaba con una batijita y la peluca. You know, a little nightgown and without the you know, the glam. What, is she gonna sleep with the eyelashes? No. Normal.
Although she was diva to the end.
A human like everybody else. She wasn't an alien. Even though people, you know, portrayed her like, what the, you know, is that? But was what made her famous. That's why after this year made 30 years that my mother passed. That's why she's still remembered. That's why she's still being played. That's why, you know, we're working together to keep this legacy alive, because it was something out of this world that people need to know and appreciate it. And forget the hype. Forget what you hear in the media. Get to know the real person, or ask the family. We're more than willing to share what we know, you know? And it's sad how they portrayed her, but guess what? She never cared. Still did her thing. So, you know, but she's my queen. And I'm sure she's everybody else's, you know? So there was no wrongdoing.
Anani, I think she answered that last question.
Yeah.
Like, what do you want the world to know and understand about your mom?
Yeah, she already answered it. It's perfect. Yeah.
But I have a question for you. I know that, first of all, it has been, I have heard you sing. Your voice is so much like your mom. You did an event with my group. You sang Oriente. And I had Nikki Marrero on timbales, and I have to say, on that stage, I felt, and I gotta tell you, on that stage, watching you guys, I felt like the spirit of your mother and Tito Puente were on that stage.
Yeah.
Now, I also know you're into music, and you do a little bit of rap. What's your favorite music right now? Are you into reggaeton? Are you into hip hop? Are you into rap? And who do you like? Who are you into?
I'm under management. No. I want to give a special thanks to my manager, Roberto Chango. We've worked really hard for this journey. It's been about 4 years. It's been on pause. It has, you know, stop for personal reasons. But, you know, all I could say is, you know, we always fall in compliance. It's not only management, it's like a brother to me. I'm much respect and much love to him. But I learned a lot from him. You know, never scolding, never just showing things. Because yeah, I sing for fun, but you gotta learn how to breathe, and you gotta, you know, and you should know this. You're La Lupe's daughter. Yes, I know this, but no matter how much I breathe, I'm not gonna hit those notes. So, you know, there's a lot of things that I appreciate from what I've learned. But my personal, I'm kind of like a rock star, white chick type of thing. I don't know. I must have been in another lifetime, but I like Blue October. I like The Police. You know, don't kill me. I love Jenny Rivera, Amy Winehouse, Hector Lavoe, Blue October, The Police, Billy Joe, I'm Still Standing, yeah. You know, Celeste
Mendoza.
I love them. Porque tenía una cosa que me viene. Like she shakes you up with her, you know. So I like a lot of different stuff, and I like Shania Twain too. You know, like I'm very versatile. But when we're focusing on the journey that we're focusing, I was taught none of those people are gonna put food in the table. It's Lupe. Lupe, 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 Lupe. You know, and I have to respect that because it's right, you know. But I do have a lot of, you know, I like La India, you know. I like Cardi B. What am I going to do? You know, like, I'm a normal person, just like Lupe was. So I have a whole different type of, I like a lot of different type of music. And I also enforce that on my son. I have a 20-something your old son, and he's a musician as well. And like he'll sit here and play Johnny Cash and Frank Sinatra. And he's like, thank you, mama. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm so sorry what I did to you, my child. But you have to show them all different types of genre. That's a real musician. That's a real artist. So I hope I don't get in trouble. Those are all my, you know, specialties, you know. I won't get in trouble. It's a piece of heaven.
Mira, what do you think of the future of Latin music? Dance, kick-ass music. I mean, Eddie Romero is still holding it up.
Because, unfortunately, we're losing all our salsa, especially females. And I want to give a big shout-out, de corazón, to La India, and Yolanda Rivera, you know, Yolanda Rivera from Sonora Ponceña. And, you know, she also did sing with Tito Puente. once or twice when she was younger. And that's the biggie. You know what I'm saying? Y es boricua, y es del barrio, ¿tú entiendes? Y la India, olvídate. You know, like, from singing freestyle, you know, to, you know, turning over and singing salsa. And, you know, I admire those two women, you know? And it saddens me because we don't have a lot of females left.
I know.
And we, you know, it worries me a lot, a little bit, but hopefully this is why I want our young people that have talent. Sing. Don't be afraid. Bring out your talent. Let's hear it because we need it, you know? And I like reggaeton and it's taking over. Bad Bunny, I love them all. Pero que we need to stay in tradition as far as the salsa, el mambo, la rumba. ¿Tú entiendes?
Yeah.
Pero el reggaeton is taking over and hey, you know, I applaud them too because in this time and age, especially these past going on 4 years, somehow, some way, whatever music, it kept us moving forward in what we're going through in this world as far as the pandemic and everything. So I appreciate the reggaeton. I appreciate, you know, everything else. And, you know, I love Marc Anthony, pero que se me está apagando la salsa and we can't let that happen. And we have to give glory to the ones that deserve it and the ones that are left. And I am with all my heart and thank them, those two women that I mentioned. Thank you for still making us dance and still being stand.
So we're going to hear a little bit in the future about the future projects of La Yoli, right? We're going to be hearing something soon?
Yeah. I would love to. I'm always willing and able. If we stop our project, it's for different reasons. It takes time and effort and hard work.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to put something out there when it's not concrete and it's worth people saying, hey, let me go pay this $40 ticket to hear this girl, you know? And, you know, it's going to be a tribute to La Lupe. It's going to be a tribute to my mother. And then after a while, you know, I'm sure I'll be able to do my own thing, you know, and I do my own thing anyway. One thing you said, I sound like her. Un poquitito. That high pitch at my 40-something is hard. She was a soprano. I'm not yet a soprano, pero que I do my own thing. But I can help you. Once I'm on stage, I don't know if you've ever seen me perform, it's like, whoo. And they said, and I've heard people criticize me, oh, she's imitating her mother and this and this and that. I'm not. I am me. I am La Yoli with hyphen. Yoli, no. Yoli with hyphen. I'm going to explain my name. My mother's name was Lupe Victoria Yoli Raimond. I carried her last name, just to be clear. So it's not La Yoli, it's La Yoli, you know? So I know they said, oh, she's imitating. I'm not imitating. I'm her daughter, number one. I look like her. I speak like her. I you know, and I try not to, you know? But when something just comes over you, you can't help it. Yeah. And my mom, as an ancestor, will always be with her children. Even if she's resting in power in heaven, she's always going to look after her children and their journey. And I feel that every time I get on stage, she's right next to me. And I can't help it. Thank you for the compliment. As far as the voice, I have my own voice.
You do.
No one like La Lupe, not even me.
Yep.
But thank you, you know. But I'm pumped. That's my story. I think we got a great interview.
Yeah.
We have a great
incredible interview.
And I will tell you, La Yoli, I totally agree with you. And no, you when you interpret your mother, all right, And that's how I call it. When you interpret your mother, you do it your way. But mm-hmm. there's so much of your mother in you. But right. you are you. And I love that about you. You do it your way because there is no one like your mother. There never will be anyone like your mother.